warm welcome to the Rectv viewers. In today's session, I am going to discuss about the transmission line equations in terms of both source parameters and receiver parameters. So first, basically, we are going to derive the basic form of equations, or technically they are called skeletal equations. And from the skeletal equations, I am going to apply those skeletal equations to source parameters and also the receiver parameters. Okay, so let us start the transmission line equations derivation. Okay, now the schematic diagram of a transmission line equation will be like this. So a transmission line can be viewed with this diagram. Now we have got two terminals on the extreme left, which are the input or source terminals, and let me name it as AA dash. So AA dash terminals correspond to the input terminals of the TL, and BB dash correspond to the output terminals of the TL. And by notation, we take that the length of the transmission line is L. That means the distance between the terminals A and B is L, and we, by notation, we take any point, arbitrary point P on the transmission line is located at a distance of x units from the input. So what is x? X is the distance between the input terminals and any arbitrary point P. Next, what is Vs? Vs, we take it as the input voltage or source voltage, and Is is the source current or input current. Similarly, Vr is the output voltage, or it is the receiver voltage, and Ir is the receiver current. Okay, Ir is the receiver current or output current. Okay, now based on this prerequisites, let us start the derivation. Now let us consider a transmission line of length L and any arbitrary point P located at a distance x units from the input terminals, and let us start the derivation. So the point P is located at a distance x units from the input terminals, and the point P dash is located at a distance of x plus dx from the terminals. That means what I am assuming here is I am assuming that between the two points P and P dash, the length of the transmission line is taken as dx. Okay, now as we know, the primary constants are L, C and G. They are specified always per unit length of the transmission line. What does it imply? We specify the resistance of a so-and-so transmission line is so-and-so ohms per either meter or kilometer. That means we always mention any quantity of these four as per unit length. Okay. Now, let us say dx is the infinitesimal small length between the two points P and P dash. Now, we know that the basic Ohm's law is V is equals to IR. Okay. And in terms of the impedances, IR can be written as I into Z. Okay, so V is equals to I into Z is the Ohm's law. And if I write the same equation in a different form, that means if I keep it I this side only, then I is going to become V by Z or V into 1 by Z. So what is 1 by Z there? Y. So the same equation as well I can write it as I is equals to V into Y, where Y stands for 1 by Z, and Y is called as the admittance of the elements or admittance of the circuit. So V is equals to IZ, or another way of representing the same equation is I equals to V into Y. Now of these four elements R, L, C, G, R and L are series elements, and G and C are parallel or shunt elements. So we can write Z as R plus J omega L. Why? Because the resistive part of the impedance is R itself. Coming to the reactance, always impedance is complex sum of resistance and reactance. So what is the series element, other series element we have? The AC series element is L. So the series reactance is simply nothing but the series impedance is R plus j omega L. Similarly, the two shunt elements are G and C. So the shunt admittance of the transmission line from the equivalent circuit of the TL is simply Y is equals to G plus j omega C. Okay, now let us start with the Ohm's law. Now if I apply the Ohm's law in between these two points P and P dash, now the potential difference, basically what is the Ohm's law, the potential difference V is equals to product of current and impedance in AC circuits. Okay, so if I apply the same equation, V minus of V plus dV. What is this? V minus of V plus dV. It is the potential difference across the points P and P dash. That is equals to simply R plus j omega L, which is the Z part. Okay, so R plus j omega L is the replacement of Z into I. Okay, and of course, since R and L are measured per unit length, so in the small length dx, what is the impedance? So we need to multiply that into dx actually. So I can write it on the RHS as minus dv, and dx, if I get it this side, minus dv by dx is equals to R plus j omega L into I. Okay, now let us call this equation as equation number one. Now let us on the same lines, if I apply KCL, that is the Kirchhoff's current law at point P, I can write I minus of I plus DI is equals to G plus J omega C into V. Why? Because we have got I is equals to V into Y. So the admittance can be replaced with G plus J omega C. So from this, I can write minus DI by DX is equals to G plus J omega C into V. Now let us call this equation as equation number 2. Okay, now if I observe equations 1 and 2, equation 1 is a first order linear differential equation in V, and if I observe equation 2, it is a linear differential equation in I. But to determine V here, to solve for V here using the differential equation concept, I should know I. In this equation, if I wanted to solve for I should know V. That means there are two equations in two interdependent unknowns. So I wanted to further do some manipulation on these two equations so as to reduce the final equation in one variable. So how can I do that? Now, if you observe keenly equation number one, if I differentiate it further once again with respect to x, what is it that I am going to get? D square V by dx square on the LHS, and on the RHS it is simply R plus j omega L is a constant, and what is the derivative of I with respect to x? It is obviously di by dx. So I can, if I further differentiate equation number one with respect to x, what do I get? D square V by dx square is equals to R plus j omega L into di by dx. Okay, now from equation 2, I can replace di by dx with g plus j omega c into v with a minus. So of course here we have got a minus. So further, how can I simplify this? Just replace di by dx with g plus j omega c into v with a minus. Okay, so effectively it is R plus j omega L into g plus j omega c into v. Okay, now this quantity, let us call it as some gamma square. Where gamma, what is meant by gamma, I will tell you at a later part of the session. Okay, so if I replace this with gamma square, so the quantity R plus j omega L into g plus j omega C, I am replacing it with gamma square. Okay, so from this, d square V by dx square is equals to gamma square into V. You call this equation number 3. Now, by a similar analysis on equation number 2, that is differentiating this on both sides with x, so here it will be d square I by dx square, and on the RHS it will be g plus j omega c into dv by dx. Okay, so further I can get it as I can replace dv by dx with minus r plus j omega l into I. So if I replace everything and finally I can arrive at an equation d square I by dx square is equals to r plus j omega l into g plus j omega c into I. So I can write it as gamma square into I. You can call it as equation number 4. Now, if you keenly observe equation number 3 and equation number 4, what is it that I can infer? They are homogeneous second order differential equations in V and I respectively. Okay. Now, the solution for this is, we can write it as CS plus PI, that is complementary function, complete solution is equals to complementary function plus particular integral. Now, let us further write it like this. So, d square v by dx square minus gamma square v is equals to 0. Now, if I observe this equation, what is it that I can infer? The RHS is going to become 0. So, whenever RHS becomes 0, PI, the particular integral, is 0. Now, coming to the only other part in the complete solution, we have got complementary function. Now, how to determine the complementary function? We need to determine its auxiliary equation. So, how to get the auxiliary equation? This d square by dx square, we replace it with the capital D square. So, from this, its auxiliary equation is, okay, its auxiliary equation we write it as A. Its auxiliary equation is d square minus gamma square into v is equals to 0. So, the auxiliary equation of equation 3 is d square minus gamma square into v is equals to 0. Now, if I solve for this, what do I get? D is equals to plus or minus gamma. So, d value is plus or minus gamma. So, whenever d takes a value of d real and distinct, so they are not repetitive, they are distinct. So whenever the auxiliary equation has got real and distinctive roots, its complementary function would be what? Its complementary function is c1 into e to the power of the first root, okay, e to the power of gamma x, so it is plus gamma here, okay, plus c2 into e to the power of minus gamma x. Okay, so whenever the real roots are real and distinctive, this is the complementary function. On similar lines, therefore, the complete solution is, so we are deriving the complete solution for equation 3 for what quantity? For V. So I can write it as V is equals to C1 into e to the power of gamma x plus C2 into e to the power of minus gamma x. Okay, now, what about the particular integral? So, this is the complementary function. Particular integral anyhow is 0. Why? Because the RHS of equation 3 is 0. Understand? So, for this reason, this is the final solution for the voltage V. So, on a similar lines, I can write I is equals to, the only change here we get is the constants, arbitrary constants will change. The arbitrary constants, I can write it as C3 and C4. So, the solution for I is C3 into e to the power of gamma x plus C4 into e to the power of minus gamma x. Now, let us call this as equation number 5 and equation number 6. Okay. Now, let us further simplify by equating e power gamma x with, so I can write e power gamma x as cos h gamma x plus sin h gamma x. Okay, and e power minus gamma x as cos h gamma minus sin h gamma x. Okay, now replacing these expressions for e power gamma x and e power minus gamma x in equations 5 and 6, 5 and 6 takes a value of, so from equation 5 I can write V as C1 into, so e power gamma x can be replaced with cos h gamma x plus sin h gamma x plus c2 into cos h gamma x minus sin h gamma x. Okay, now if I simplify further, cos h gamma x, if I take common, into c1 plus c2. Okay, and sin h gamma x into c1 minus c2. So let us assume this as a new constant capital E and this as a new constant capital B. So replacing with new constants, this is a cos h gamma x plus b sin h gamma x. On similar lines, I can get I as some new constant c cos h gamma x plus d sin h gamma x. Now, instead of, let us call this as equation number 7. Now, instead of this instead of having a, b, c, d, 4 unknown constants, we can reduce it into 2 unknown constants. Now, why should we reduce these two equations for V and I in terms of two unknown constants? Is we have, if we try to solve these transmission line equations either in terms of source parameter or in terms of receiver parameters, we have got two conditions. Okay, so we have got two initial conditions, so we can solve only two unknown constants. So by some means we need to convert both the equations V and I in terms of two unknown constants. So how is it possible? Is if you observe equation number 2, okay, so if you observe equation number 1, what is equation number 1? If you observe, it is dv by dx is equals to minus r plus j omega l into v. Okay, so what was equation number 1? If you remember, dv by dx is equals to minus r plus j omega l into I. This was equation number 1. Okay, now from this, what is I? I is equals to minus 1 by r plus j omega l into d by dx of v. So v from equation 7 I can substitute as a cos h gamma x plus b sin h gamma x. Okay, now what is derivative of cos h gamma x with respect to x? It is, for cos h gamma, it is sin h gamma x into derivative of the internal function gamma x. What is the derivative of internal function gamma x? It is simply gamma. So I can write it as minus, so here it is a, so the derivative of this first term would be a sin h gamma x into gamma, and here it is b cos h gamma x into gamma. So in both the functions I am getting a gamma constant, so I can throw gamma out. Gamma by r plus j omega l, okay, into, what is the derivative here remaining, is a sin h gamma x plus b cos h gamma x. Now what was gamma v2? We assumed gamma square is equals to r plus j omega l into g plus j omega c. So from that, what is gamma? Gamma was under root of r plus j omega l into g plus j omega c. Okay, so if I substitute gamma here, so and what would be gamma by the gamma by r plus j omega l? It is obviously minus 1 by, so we are going to have the term g plus j omega c in the numerator. So minus root of g plus j omega c divided by r plus j omega l into the same expression. Now if you observe, g plus j omega c has got a units of mho and r plus j omega l has got a unit of ohm. So mho by ohm has got a unit of mho square. Okay, or if I get this g plus j omega c down, what is it that is going to happen? Minus 1 by r plus j omega l is already in the denominator. So in the denominator, r plus j omega l comes in the numerator. And this originally g plus j omega c was in the numerator. If it is transposed to the denominator, it is coming to denominator of denominator. That is g plus j omega c into the same expression. Now, if you clearly observe, under root of r plus j omega l is measured in ohms, and g plus j omega c is measured in mho. Ohm by mho will be ohm square. ohm by mho is ohm square. So 1 by this term, I can represent it in terms of ohm, under root of ohm square is, if it is coming out, it is ohm. So ohm is the unit of impedance. So this term in the square root, this is going to represent an impedance. And more clearly or more specifically, we call this term inside the under root, I mean this term root of R plus omega L divided by G plus omega C as the characteristic impedance of the TL. That is, the what is the exact name given to this impedance? It is called as the characteristic impedance of the transmission line, and it is represented as Z naught. So I can write it as minus 1 by Z naught into, yeah, the term in the bracket, that is A sin h gamma x plus b cos h gamma x. Okay, and you call this equation number 8. Yeah, equation number 8 and equation number 7, these two equations are called the skeletal equations of the transmission lines or the basic equations of the transmission lines. And it is from these two equations we are going to derive the transmission line equations in terms of the source parameters and in terms of the receiver parameters. Okay, so after this topic I am going to discuss how we derive the transmission line equations in terms of source parameters. Now let us derive the transmission line equations in terms of source parameters. So to derive these transmission line equations in terms of source parameters, we should know what are the source conditions. Now what are the source conditions? If you observe the schematic of the transmission line, so these two are the source points. That means the arbitrary point P, which was there somewhere at some distance from the source, it got to the source point only. So when the arbitrary point is itself the source point, what would be x? Since the distance between the source and the source point itself is 0, I can say that at x equals to 0. So that means x takes a value of 0 for source. Okay, at x equal to 0, what is this voltage? Voltage is Vs and the current is Is. So I is equals to Is and V is equals to Vs. Okay, now let us substitute x equals to 0, I equal to Is and V equal to Vs in equation number 7 and 8. Now if I substitute x equals to 0 and V is equals to Vs in equation number 7, what do I get? Vs is equals to A into 0, sorry, A into 1, Y1, because cos h gamma x is what? E power gamma x plus e power minus gamma x by 2. And if I take x equals to 0, it is going to become e power 0 plus e power minus 0 by 2, or 1 plus 1 by 2, which takes a value of 2 by 2, which is 1. So Vs is equals to A into 1 plus B into, now when cos is 1, sine takes a value of 0 because there is a minus between the two exponentials in case of a sine term, sine hyperbolic sine term. So obviously what is A here? A is Vs. Now let us substitute the second condition. If I substitute the second condition, I is going to become Is. Is is equals to minus 1 by Z naught into, okay. Now A into sin H0 takes a value of 0. Okay. Why? Because sin H0 is the difference between two exponentials raised to the power 0. Next, coming to this, B into 1. So B into 1 implies what is B? B is equals to minus Is into Z naught. Okay. Therefore, what is V is equals to? V equals to, yeah, A is what? A is Vs. V is Vs into cos H gamma X minus Is Z naught into sin H gamma X. This is the expression for V if we know the source parameters Vs and Is. Okay, next, coming to I. I is minus 1 by Z naught into, what is that? Minus 1 by Z naught into A is V. S. Vs into sin h gamma x minus I z naught into cos h gamma x. Or if I go for a slight simplification here, minus 1 by z naught into minus I z naught will be is. So I can write it as is cos h gamma x minus vs by z naught into sin h gamma x. Okay, so this is the expression for I. So you call it as equation number 1 and 2. So what are these equations 1 and 2 called? They are the transmission line equations in terms of source parameters. Okay, so in the next session I am going to derive the transmission line equations in terms of receiver parameters.